From all around the world have played this music, this kind of music you just heard. Yeah, what have you played?
Many folk.
Folk yeah. Music?
Is it like choro?
Shodin.
No.
Okay.
This music here is actually by Gaspar Fernandez, he's from Mexico. And this is from Giorgi, and this was actually my starting point of this research. So, because for myself, I haven't been taught in South American, Latin, Baroque music, and being like very keen on the Latin American culture, I thought, okay, I'm dancing salsa, but how can I connect that to my musicianship as a classical musician? And the teachers asked, they don't know almost anything about Latin America, and so I thought, okay, starting from zero, how can I find out maybe some composers and maybe what went on over there, and because that will create a whole new repertoire. And that's why Baroque music in Colombia, because Colombia is more relevant to me because I was born there, and also it was to narrow it down because the whole Latin America is very big. And of course I was very much interested in then how the recorder had a role, so the appearance of the recorder is also a part of my research. I want to go into three topics now. First, the history, because I thought, how can I know anything about what went on over there? You can call it Baroque music even, because Baroque music is a European term. And by then I had to know the history of Colombia, and that has like 320 years of colonization by Spain. So I thought, I have to know when and how the Spaniards interacted with the indigenous people. And the only lead I had on that is that I knew there was a lot of evangelization, that means they brought religion and missions. But I didn't know anything else. But I thought, if I know something of that, then maybe I will also find in those areas information and sources on my topic. Next area that will be the appearance of the recorder. If I can find any evidence of the recorder, because searching on the internet, I didn't find anything. There's a lot from Mexico and Bolivia, where there were a lot of missions going on, but Colombia, hardly nothing. The last thing I wanted to find out was, of course, music and scores, because I knew there were music teaching, also through religion, but also I wanted to know composers. There were vaguely one composer, but I didn't know. And maybe those composers has interesting music. So through this research and this presentation, I would like to tell you about this, but also the procedure I have gone through during my research time. First, the colonization of Colombia. Despite its name, Colombia, actually it was not Colombians going over there first, it was Alonso de Ojeda. And he was a Spanish navigator and explorer. And if you think he might look like someone in the room, he actually is born in Cuenca, which
like
is
me.
Where Maria is from. So we were speaking about relatives back in the time. Well, actually he was supposed to go to Mexico, but he went through the coast and ended up in North Colombia, and he liked it so much, so he actually stayed for some time. And from here they started the myth of a country of gold. You also heard the name El Dorado. So by then more people got interested. And Rodrigo de Bastidas was actually the first real, he came with the real group which invaded Colombia. So this happened in 1525, and the north of Colombia, really close to Venezuela and close to Caribbean, it's called Santa Marta, and he went there. And the next one, Pedro Heredia, was the most important one because he founded Cartagena, which is the main time I'm gonna speak about in my research. In 1533, he founded Cartagena. And the special thing about Cartagena is that it was actually a big, big port of shipments of supplies, and among that, like materials from Europe, there was also enslaved African. And actually has been kind of the biggest port of enslaved Africans. 73,000 African people came through that port. And among the whole Latin American, it's a lot. And this is only recorded. I'm sure there was a lot more. And this is also the foundation, like, why Colombia is one of the most diverse countries in the world. And in South America, only Brazil is also as diverse. So why is it? That is because it's indigenous people, native people, was already in Colombia. Then there was the Spaniards, which came to Colombia, and then there was the African, actually West African. And these three, of course, came with each of their own culture, which was mixed in Colombia, and now has a huge diversity. And we also know from dances, choreography, and rhythms, you know, from Africa, and more the clothes. We also know from flamenco music that comes from Spain. So the whole Colombian culture is actually a mixture of these. These three. Let's see here. You can see Santa Marta here, where the first came, and then here is Cartagena. And that is not the capital nowadays. As you might have known, that's Bogota is here. And I'm gonna speak about this because that's the capital, we know now, but it actually also became the center at that time. There were three expeditions. Expedition one, it's called Jimenez de Quesada. He came from up here and through the Magdalena River, came here, and he actually founded two tribes fighting against each other, and that was why maybe it was easy to conquer. And he founded actually Santa Fe de Bogota, which was that's now it's just called Bogota. And he did that in 1538, and from Venezuela. Oh, actually number two expedition came from Ecuador, up here, called Cauca, and went in here. And the last one who found their way all into the center of Colombia was from Venezuela, called Fetterman, not a Latin name. And they all fought for like winning the most area, and it was not before 1550 the Spanish king made a call and got everything under control and got it under the viceroyalty of Peru. And this is also interesting because maybe in future it will also be interesting to know more about Peru, what has going on there, because yes, the different countries are different, but at that time, how they were colonized, there's a lot of similarities. But in this research I'm going to focus what I could find from Colombia about musical developments there in the early colonial period. So, the Spanish came there and they used a word called encomienda, to entrust. So, a little bit different than the Portuguese. The Spanish for sure was brutal as well, but encomienda, to entrust, means they tried to win the native side in the sense that they were working for them, but they were also having responsibility for the native people, giving them food and educate them, and also introducing them for the Catholic faith, that means religion. And here we come to the evangelization. So through that there came different groups, the Franciscan and the Dominicans, 1550. After that Augustinians, 1575, and it was not before Jesuits. The 1589, then the Jesuits came, and those is the main group I'm going to speak about, because somehow, because of their experience, they who have the dominant mission, the dominant role of Colombia and the Colombians. They build a lot of mission, that means they build there are houses, and they really decided about the native people. We made big schools, and I'm going to speak more about that. They taught the indigenous. Okay, I'm going to show you now, because I thought it would maybe be nice to give you a picture of how maybe this could have happened. So, do you know the mission? It's a movie.
The film.
The film, and it's actually a movie with Robert De Niro. Why is this interesting? Because it was one of the first movies encountered this topic, and I have cut a few clips together, so you can first of all see maybe how the Jesuits came and tried to make their way through some tribes to get to be friends with them, but also how in this particular case, it's not about Colombia, but the film is recorded in Colombia. Also how the native were underneath, also enslaved and killed. Also because later the Jesus was actually the one protecting them not to be enslaved, so that means the King of Spain and Portuguese, they wanted to kill everyone because they wanted money.
Christians of these people.
If you have the time.
So, a short view. That was why they had so much succeed, the Jesuits, because they indoctrinated the indigenous through music and like won their, I'll say, that they are confident, we can say, in that way. Okay, so my next step in this research were, I thought, okay, so I found there were some missions in Colombia. Let me see where they took place so I could find sources there. So the most important missions were in Cundinamarca, where also the capital, Bogotá, is, and Puebla, these two regions next to each other. And they named three important cities, Futibon, Duitama, and Tobaga. And to make it a bit easier for you, by the way, I'm going to use a lot of Spanish terms, so if you don't remember something, you just ask me. So Cundinamarca is the pink area here, region, and the Boyacá, you see it here, that's the blue one here. And we see Duitama here, and I'm going to speak about these towns again, because the missions, they were the main missions here, but and later they went on to the Nero and Arauca, those areas. But it's very interesting to go into these things because we see that, I think actually you can see here, Tunia for instance, and there's one more, Tunia and Bogota, they were actually the main cultural centers, the first one in Colombia, and it's actually the same place as the mission, so the mission really had a big influence. And it was not only music which went on here, it was also like carpenter, like working with wood. There were a big school, or two big schools made, where they started to also build. And also the inside of a church, you can see they built the chairs, the other pieces. And we can also see in those places that there's a lot of similarities to Spain, because these schools were not by native people, it was by Spanish, and it was about learning the stylistic design from Spain. But if we go there, we can see beautiful ornaments in the churches, but it's still from like this war in Spain. I'm gonna show you one thing, because what we can find, what we look at, iconography, we look at sculptures, we look at paintings, and anything also related to music. But there's actually only very few instruments from that time preserved. One of them is the harp of Tobaga. I told you the city before is in Boyacá, the Blue region. And what is very interesting here is that we can connect that they didn't only order instruments from Europe, but they made also instruments. So there was a connection between this carpenter, cabinet makers, which also made organ boxes and so on, to the harp. To music, so that means the wood, and also to music making, musical instrument making. If you look here, it was from the harp, and you see these round ornaments here, and this is from the other place, also in the Paris of Tobaga, and they're the same. So that means there has been a connection, there has been made instruments there, and they were building also in ornaments from the churches. Then, of course, I was interested, what about the recorders? And unfortunately, I haven't found anything of iconography in all the sources I have looked at. There has been a lot of instruments shown, but not recorders. So what I did find was David Lasogi. He had made an ordering list from Europe to Colombia and to South America. I only found three towns in Colombia where this is mentioned recorder. But there was quite some evidence, so in Chocontá, Fomica and Cartagena, I found three, in each of the towns I found that they mentioned that they have ordered recorders. The first actually place in South America I found, it was in Guatemala, to the bishop there, that he had ordered a caja de flautas, which means a box of flutes, and that means consort instruments, like a group of consort instruments. So it was in the 16th century. But let's see in Colombia where that has been. Chocontá is also here, and also Fomica is here. So both in Cundinamarca. And the last one in Cartagena, as we saw before. Let's see the first one here. Chocontá, it says an entire set of shawms with their recorders, all new. It's quite evident. What it also shows is that shawms with their recorders. And what is it? Tirimirs. Shawms is the predecessor of the oboe, double reed instrument. And to look at, we know it a lot from Spain and Europe that, that instrument was also there. And we also know that they were accompanied by sackbuts and dulcians, trombone and bassoon and cornets. Those examples was called cabillas, and the members from there is called ministrelles. And I'm gonna say that name again. But the interesting part here is that recorders has been connected to the chirimia. So I thought everything I found from the tirimias and ministrels, there's a big percentage of skewness that the recorder has been used as well, maybe as a color. The next down, it says a set of shawms which I gave to the Church of Our Lady, also another old set with its trombone, also a horn, also an arantiella, also four recorders for the season of Lent. Second evidence, we again see that it's connected to the shawms, the telemir. And also another interesting thing is that the season of Lent, that's religious preparation to Easter. And that means, I think, that the recorder was not only used as a teaching instrument, it was also used as a professional instrument for ceremonies. And it's another argumentation for recorders have been included in ministries with all the other, like on the same level as other instruments. Mm-hmm. The last one, Cartagena. Seven sets of recorders appear in the account of the Jesuits College. So that was the first house for the Jesuits in Cartagena. The thing is why I haven't spoken more about Cartagena is that up there, I was the last year, it's super warm and the humidity is super high. So there's no sources left, simply. And there was pirates and it's been stolen, so simply there's not so much sources. Those that have read, they say rather search in Bogota because it's 8,600 feet. That means almost three kilometers. That means 2 kilometers, 600 meters high. If you go to Bogota, you can also feel the high there, and it's cold, almost like here. So simply the sources for this is better preserved.
Patricia, sorry, in the former, the previous who? Which I gave to the church. So who is this person again?
Oh, sorry. Let me just go back. The Church of Our Lady.
Yeah, but who is giving it?
Oh, sorry. That I don't know.
Okay. So this is a quote that you found.
Yeah.
You found from Lasocki.
Yeah, Lasocki, and I just got the quote. Is also see here. It's from a bigger set.
Yeah. So you don't know if this is a Spaniard that wrote that, or a Colombian?
No.
Okay.
I can just double check because I have the whole list in my. Also, maybe I can actually look here because I had it as an appendix.
It's okay. It's okay. I mean, just a detail, important one. But
it doesn't say. Yeah, quote maestro Fray Francisco de San José. I, the parish priest, Fray Francisco de San José.
So he brought it. He brought it from Spain.
Yeah, I guess so, but I don't know, also the other ones, I don't know who was the first one to that, but I guess it was in the mission, the Spanish say we need instruments.
So there is actually not a link to a possible making of recorders in Colombia.
No, that,
but most likely, not like the harp that was made there, it was brought from Spain.
I see no, I have not found
that.
Maybe guitars, other things, which is not called guitars.
Yeah.
And it's also really pity in all the iconographies. I almost see something, but it's probably not more a cornetto. So that's still very strange to me. Oh, where are we? Yes, so that's the reason I'm not searching more in Cartagena, I'm searching in Bogota. I just want to connect the things because I said it was so important to look into the missions because it was there the cultural center happened, where the things happened. And another argumentation is for that is in the mission from Tibun, is an area I told before, is actually found in the documents there. It says indigenous ministrants, the examples, members, have been lent out for services and celebrations and processions. And that means it's actually really close to. What that does mean? That means that they often, there was a minister, there was an example connected to a church, and they often lend those ministries to each other. I found most, I'm not going to go into it now, but I found more sources say for a special occasion they were having a ministry from a few towns, and among those towns there was actually Tocunta, just the town where the recorder list was before. That means in Tocunta, where recorders for sure has been playing, there was important ministry, which was also linked out to other towns. And that means the recorder might have had a role again amongst the other instruments. Also another thing, it says, a part of this, it says, also says it's ministries of the instrument telemia, corneta, and other instruments of this kind, which might refer to the recorder again. Another fun detail is the register of indigenous musicians, because after a while they actually got a surname, and the surname was not, I don't know, Madsen, anything else. It was Kanda, Lautero, Kromitero, Bajonero. I think you can understand what yeah. it might have meant. And of course there was also the flute, so it can be a bit vague, but for sure the flute has a role. Even though it might not have been recorded, the flute itself has been having a role, or else I don't think they will also put it so important as a flautero, as a surname. And she also hold families for generations, having their names actually until today. Churches as the musical center, musical centers. Another clip from the movie, just to give you a picture. How much music have had.
Though I knew that everywhere in Europe states were tearing at the authority of the church, and though I knew well that to preserve itself there the church must show its authority over the Jesuits here, I still couldn't help wondering whether these Indians would not have preferred that the sea and wind had not brought any of us to them.
To round off the recorder chapter. So it was limited resources, but I think it is shown that they were used in the ministeries and have been an extra color to the telemias, the chants, as I just told you about. And another thing is that a lot of this music were vocal, so all this wind instrument has been colored up anyhow to the vocal. In churches, the priest got a very important role, because it was quite normal. It became more normal that the priest was not only a priest, but he was also a teacher to the indigenous people. He had knowledge about music and music theory. And I have several names saying how great Juan de Castellanos was, former soldier, but he had a great knowledge of music theory and polyphonic music. And how one from Cartagena has been compared to the famous Flemish composer, Johansen de Prime, which you might know. So the churches became musical centers for indigenous people to learn, and also kids, like children, but with the best voices, were collected, and they of course needed to have fidelity. And praise God. In my research, I found, I think, 5 main composers, but I focused on 2 of them, because they had like 100 or 100 years of influence in the cathedral of Bogota. José de Cascante, he was the chapel master from 1674 till his death, and he had typical liturgical music. and he wrote many romances, letras, and villancicos, which I'm going to speak about in a minute. So all songs in couplets, and he mainly wrote for duos and trios. And also his music is so written down, he very much used the harp as an accompaniment. So organ was used as an accompaniment, but also harp was has a big role in Colombia in this time. Of extra detail is that it's one of his villancicos, also honor this Our Lady, and also saying a specific town, this is the same town that the recorders might have been. So I'm not going more into it now, but I have been able to connect a bit also his music. The next one, Juan de Herrera. He was born in Bogota, the Santa Fe, and he was master of the also of the Cathedral of Bogota. The difference between him was that he is actually the most he has one of the most the composer who have written most music, and he got really well known. So after Cascante, he took over and he actually opened up and wrote even more kind of music. He also wrote also in Latin, which is very special. And he was also teaching music for Santa Ines, a convent, next to his other duties. But yeah, he wrote also choir pieces and also the spazio continuo, invitation, psalms, masses, all kind of things. Also villancicos and romances. What to call it out is that he also wrote two psalms. For two and three choirs, and it's interesting because they have actually been reworked by Spanish composers and are now in Spain. So that means he was a very famous and composer. So my small step into playing some of this music, that I had to find some scores. So I went to Adrian's house. It was Musica Temporanea, if you've heard about that. And I didn't find so many scores, but I found a few. And I'm just going to show a little tip I did with some people you know, by Juan de Herrera, a villancico.
Oh my god.
Which version is that?
On the other hand, is quite interesting because it has had a huge development. It started out as a Spanish song, not liturgical, how to say that? Liturgical. And actually, it's later in the 16th century, it became used more and more in churches for ceremonies, at Christmas time, and that's also how we know the villancico today. And in the 17th century, it has also been accompanied, like a melody with accompaniment. So it has really been changed through times. And what I would like to find more, which I couldn't find for this research, is there's ethnic differences. That means that villancico has also been used not in churches, also with a lot of rhythm and dialects. I will make a connection to the first song I started out this presentation with. It was Mexican, but you could hear it was not in Spanish, or I don't know if you could hear, but it was actually in a native language, Nahuatl. So there was another way the Jesuits used the way they taught them about music, but on the other hand, the indigenous people could use their own language and perform maybe better that way, or be more willing to play and to learn more. And that is also happening in Colombia, but it's all so it's very difficult to find scores about it. Another thing, a subgenre, so just speak shortly about, negrillas, negros, and guineas. That's actually Spanish rooted, no sorry, African, but it comes from the Spanish Ciclo de Oro theater, and actually it's looking a bit down on Africans. They make fun of Africans, like black people, the African character. I will not go more into what that means now, but especially those villain seekers, they're more, way more rhythmical. They also distinguish or with the having a ternary metric alternation between 6/8 and 3/4. And we also know in folkloric music there's a lot of this happening. And it could be very interesting to get to know also these kind of villain seekers, not only the sacred ones we know from churches. And of course the ones from these two performances composers, and which I have played a bit with now, also with Gabriel, they are very much related to the Spanish style. So these other villain seekers, they have a bit another approach as well. You also see it in Cuban music, they have preserved this music way more. It's because in Cartagena, for instance, in Colombia, the Spanish did not allow this kind of music in churches. In Cuban, on the other hand, from the God and all this music, they have they are playing it a lot more, and they have like preserved it more this root of tradition. Okay, so conclusion to my travel in this field. Baroque music in Colombia. It was a question if I could even call it that, if there is what we call Baroque music. And I got, I think, a huge knowledge about from learning about the history, and I have to say, like, the answer to this is yes, because we find music in Colombia, and we find music which is exactly like in Spain. So that means the music came over there, they were taught it, also the instruments came there, and after the Spaniards, there also came Italians with their violins and violin music. So all this, tradition came over there, and yes, so that's Baroque music in Colombia. The appearance of the recorder, it was very difficult to find, but I think I have argumented a few ways that the recorder was happening, it was played, it was not only a teaching instrument, it was also used professionally. How much we don't know, maybe it's just been a color. I think that is... yeah, of course, I had a very limited time now for my research, and throughout my research I had more and more questions. So, first of all, as a musician, I could go three ways now, I think, because in those churches... Oh, first of all, that music I found was actually... Maria also saw it, that, oh, but that's Spanish music. So I think I would need to learn much more about maybe Spanish music, where there's a lot of more, like, more sources, how to play music, rules, and so on. So maybe I should learn about Spanish music to help myself to understand this music better. And maybe also if I search in libraries and so on in Spain, maybe I will also find more information about the colonization of the South America and Colombia, and maybe some useful information about sources of Colombia and scores. That's one way, which I want to do myself. But as a musician, I could make a big group with double choir and baroque organ, a lot of singers and all this, to make it the real way. But I think the recorder will have a very small role in that setting, but that's definitely how the music was played. There's another way, since we are playing so much vocal music here with concert instruments, and we knew there were concert instruments over there as well, then maybe it's my quintet group, I could choose to just play concert music with the music there to get to know it, because there's some really, really beautiful music and motets and so on found. And as you then saw in the video, there's also another way that I could just mixture, maybe the recorder has in one line itself and the vocal have another sound, mixed few vocals but not a whole choir. Maybe it's a good way to start to get to know this music. For sure there's a lot of nice music found there. last but not least, if you want to read more, because I have to leave things out, I also recorded on the whole song and another song, you can take it on if you have a QR. Otherwise, you can ask me some questions now.
Right, thank you. Questions?
What is the name of this Shaska the gay kind of guy?
Juan Pérez Medrano is canon and a priest, and they were said about him great ability for choir and so on. And then Juan de Castellanos, which was the first one I mentioned, was the first one mentioned, and he was having a lot of knowledge. He was the one saying that this guy, he knows what he's doing.
Have you heard his music?
No, he was not actually a part of the sources. I didn't find so much. I was scanning in advanced phase. That means, I actually was not able to find any scores on the internet. So Edwin, who helped me out with even finding some scores from Colombia. If we go to any other place, there's just a good article now about Bolivia, how they have found actually, in the middle of nowhere, new scores. And in a small church somewhere, and some of Insec had been eating some of it, but there's a whole manuscript of things. In Colombia, I think they are very much behind. Yes, Cartagena is humid and there's maybe not things preserved, but the Colombians is also behind about digitalizing. So maybe, I have been in Colombia and I also have seen Herrera, the guy who founded Cartagena. I went there, but if I had to focus, I would definitely know more now to know what to look for. Also Bogota, the cathedral, and if I look on the internet, there says there's some really interesting books I would like to get in hand, but I would have to go there. It's not digitalized anything. Mm-hmm. At least what I found, I will go there again, and then, but at least what I'm really happy about this research, from starting from knowing nothing, I know the history, I also know names, I know how it went, and also if I have to ask, there's some groups, small groups doing things, and I can now go to them, maybe asking more specifically what I'm looking for. Yeah.
Is the music still performed there a lot now?
No. What do you mean?
Because in Bolivia they still really perform music.
Well, in churches, yes. About the recorder? No. The recorder is really not so famous there, I guess it went out. And the other ones I'm actually really curious myself, especially because I know more folkloric music. So these villancicos I'm speaking about, I think they're more oral. I mean, you have to be there and know the people, because I don't know.
Is it your ambition to put a full program with Baroque Colombian music?
Yes, but it was so clear, it was also starting out with this music I presented for you, which is actually Mexican. I didn't get disappointed, but it went another turn. So the thing I actually found was not exactly what I looked for in the beginning. It was more like sacred music. So I think I would go more interesting in knowing the other kind of villancicos, maybe knowing some of this other, like Edwin, he went to some Argentinian street and then he was listening to a guy.
From the pool, the person you're talking about.
Yeah, writing down the music directly from a guy. It's not written anywhere, this kind of thing. But I would love to know more about this. And also because many has done research in Mexico, Bolivia, Peru, but not in Colombia so much, as far as I know. So then you have new repertoire, which maybe nobody really plays, at least not here.
Any other questions?
No.
Okay, thank you, Patricia. Cool.